I love my job. I love the people who I work with, and I love what I do. I know, crazy, right? If this were good, I'm right here. But the funny thing about life is that when you're up here and you're feeling really good, it's really easy for things to go really wrong really quickly. Now let me tell you about a particular Monday when I walked into work. I call it my Monday fun days. I roll in and I'm like, look at this glorious cubicle. I'm so excited for the day. I'm gonna do some fun stuff today. And then the phone rings. And I look and the caller ID says, Big Boss. He normally doesn't call me. Hello? Yeah? Right now? Okay. Weird. I couldn't help but feel nervous as I was walking down the hallway, and I usually like peek in, so I tried it. I was like, hey, and he's looking at his computer. So I creep into the office, and I sit down, and I wait for what seems like forever, and then he looks away from his computer, and he looks at me, and he says, Ryan, I've been watching you and your social media. No, no, sir, I can explain. I can explain it all. Puts his big boss hand out, and it just stops me. And I'm thinking to myself, am I about to lose my job? Whew. Well, before I finish where that went, I want to take us all back in time to when we were all asked a single, simple, powerful question. Ryan, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, some people want to be doctors, lawyers, superheroes. My two-year-old nephew, he wants to drive backhoes. Okay, that's cool, whatever you want. I wanted to grow up, and I really thought I had a chance of becoming a professional ice hockey goaltender. I was small, but I was fast, but it didn't work out. Now in college, I had another idea, and I thought, you know what? I am made to be a movie producer. I'm gonna make it. And that didn't work either. But in the process, I really found out what I was passionate about, and that's communicating through storytelling. So today, I'm gonna share my story with you and hopefully teach you a couple things that I learned that might make sense for you. Now, if I'm gonna get into this communication thing, I have to think about what are the communication tools? And there's one big one that stands out, and it's called the internet. And on the internet, all the stories and all the conversations are happening on this thing called social media. And who's the best at social media? Millennials. I heard it. How many millennials we got here? Make some noise. All right. Well, congratulations, because I'm a Gen X. But it's complicated. And let me explain. Because technically, I'm a millennial. You see, millennials are all those cool kids that are born in the early 1980s to the early 1990s. And what that does is put this whole generation into a generalization. And that's the problem when it comes to describing a large group of people over an amount of time where technology continues to change. Now, millennials get a bad rap. People are claiming that they're always on their phone, that they're somehow hard to manage, and that they are entitled. Well, I don't think so. I think that they are very adaptable, and I think they're very savvy at social media, and they are very entrepreneurial. This is where my struggle is, because I associate with some of those things, but not really all of those things, and I'm not that good at social media. I want you to imagine for a moment a visualization, a football goal post, right? Big old yellow one like this. I want you to think of all millennials in between those posts. So over here you have all of those young millennials born in the 1990s. And over here you have all the young millennials that are born in the 1980s. Well, I was born in 1980. So I am hanging onto this pole. Some days I feel like a Gen X, some days I feel like a millennial. Gen X, millennial. And it's very, very confusing. The struggle is real. So what do I do? I obviously do a lot of soul searching and searching online, and I found out that I have something called borderline millennial disorder. Yeah, this way, I'm here, I'm over here, I'm over here. And I'm thinking to myself, what is it that these millennials really have? Well, they're adaptable, and that's because they grew up with technology. Well, I did too, sort of, right? My brother had a 1976 Volkswagen bus with an 8-track, yeah. And I remember that I had a boombox, detachable speakers, 2 cassette tapes, you could record stuff from the radio. Then there was these CDs, and CDs became MP3s, and MP3s became Spotify. Now, millennials are also good at social media because they grew up with it. I did not. I'm a Gen X. In middle school and high school, I'm going to tell you things were a lot more pure. And I'll tell you why. Because if you didn't like me or you wanted to call me Freckle Juice, you had to do it to my face, not to my Facebook. And in college, believe it or not, I didn't have social media. So you actually had to talk to people. Now, everyone who doesn't understand that, think of social media, but just without the media part. Just actually socializing. I was an early adapter because I was destined to master this thing called communication. When MySpace came out, I had my own space. When Facebook came out, I was right there. And then when I heard about Twitter, I'm like, oh, I'm going to tweet. And I was like, tweet, tweet. Do you know what all this social media got me? Absolutely nothing. No love at all. In fact, it was frustrating, it was distracting, and it made me feel bad about myself because everybody's doing so well. So I just left it alone. And I left it alone, and I thought to myself, after a certain amount of time, I can't just leave this alone. If everyone's on the internet and everyone's communicating through social media, I gotta figure this out. I gotta tap into my inner millennialness. And that's where I came up with a three-part plan. Step number one, call my mom. Because she always helps me when I shop. And so we went and I got my first pair of skinny jeans, yeah? And then I got those really cool button-up shirts that have buttons, but they're hidden. And I got myself a couple hipster bow ties. Step number two, get a job at a university. Zot, zot, zot. Step number three is a specific strategy I made up and I call it millennial mingling. And it means mingling with millennials. I went to where they were. I talked to them. I actually communicated and I asked a lot of questions. I got good at digging for the information that I wanted because I wanted to get good at social media. I'm going to give you an example of one party that was a millennial mingling success. I had heard about this party because it was exclusive. It was an invite only with top influencers. But it was sponsored by Microsoft. So I made a couple calls, and somehow I got myself a ticket. Yes. Then I roll up to the party in my Uber, and I get to the Hollywood Hills, and this house wasn't a house. It was a block. It had seven different layers that you could see from the outside. I walk in the main entrance, and that's a huge patio. The first thing I see is a guy with a double bass going doom, 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 doom in a cloud suit. Not like a cloud suit, but an actual designer suit that was blue with clouds on it. And this is backdropped against this crazy Hollywood Valley, and you've got the sun setting, and it's orange, and it's just epic. And I'm surrounded by people that are 10 years younger than me, 10 times more successful than me, and about 100 times better at all that social media stuff. But it's okay. I was there to work, to network. So I started asking everybody, what's up with them? How's it going? I meet somebody who works at Facebook. I met somebody who markets at Google. This guy just raised millions of dollars, and this person flew from the other side of the world to this event just today. I'm freaking out, but I'm making sure that I am finding more information from them than I'm giving to them. Every time they ask me what I do, I'm like, well, I'm a professional speaker. But I forget to tell them that I'm Now it comes time for dinner, and we're all around this big table, and I sit next to the host in hopes that I will go last. The host stands up and says, today, we are going to do things a little differently. Instead of talking about what's going right, we're going to talk about what's going wrong. I'm sitting there going, yes. I want you to talk about what you're fearful of, your darkest secrets, like what do you need the most help with? And when the first person that I heard talk, all of a sudden, they shared their deepest, darkest secrets, totally different than the ideal character that I had made them out to be. I begin to connect with this person on a human level, and the next person, and the next person, the next person, and I'm feeling good. It's my turn. I was the only person that stood up. Thank you, Toastmasters. And I said, I am going through a millennial life crisis. I'm a millennial, but I don't know about social media. I'm writing articles, but nobody reads them. And I want to be a public speaker, but nobody pays attention to me. Thank you. Sat down, and then I got a half-assed sitting ovation, so I think it went pretty good. So after the party, one gentleman came up to me and he said, Ryan, here's my card. I think I can help you. I was like, sweet. I go home, I'm exhausted, I'm excited though, and not tired enough to do legitimate cyber stalking on this guy, right? Leonard Kim, holy macaroni. This guy is a top writer on Quora. He writes for Inc., Huffington Post, entrepreneur. He's been featured on Fortune and Forbes. This guy has 10 million reads on his content, hundreds of thousands of followers, and he's not even 30 years old. I hate this guy. I need this guy. So I offered to take him out to coffee, and that coffee conversation reinforced everything that I had been learning and put me in my spot. I learned so many things from these millennials, but three stick out, and that's what I'm here to share with you. Number one, focus, 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 and focus. Leonard told me that my social media profiles look like the online equivalent of a chicken with his head cut off, running around. I was a speaker, I was an entrepreneur, I was a startup consultant, I worked at this university, I actually consulted for martial arts, and I did a sailing club thing. It's like, what the heck? So he made me focus. He said, Ryan, what are you passionate about? I'm like, communication. And he said, so what? What within communication? I said, speaking. And he said, so what? What within speaking? And I said, speaking about speaking. And he said, there you go. So all of my content became central around speaking about speaking, helping people overcome their fear of public speaking, getting entrepreneurs to communicate their idea in a way that resonates with somebody. And all of a sudden, it started to make sense. Number two, don't think of social media as a tool of distraction, but think of it as a tool of attraction. Now, I was distracted when I got online, and for anybody who gets a mobile notification because they've got somebody who likes their post, and they go into Facebook, and then you realize you've just lost an hour and a half of your life to funny cats and memes, you've been distracted too. But as soon as you think of social media as a tool of attraction, it's amazing. Because it's the people that you surround yourself with that will be the most influential in your life. You really are the average of the five people around you, but you multiply that by 5,000 people online, you want the right people. I started to engage, and when I'd like something or I'd reply, it would not just be to like it, it would be because I wanted to form a relationship, and I found that engagement drove engagement. And I'd meet these people in the real world, and we would create a bond. I am growing my net worth by growing my social network. And as soon as I started to look at it like that, it wasn't a distraction. It was something that I could use for attracting the right people in my life. And number three, which I believe is the most powerful, and I heard it throughout these conversations, don't be ideal, be real. Now, online, whether you are taking selfies or not, if you didn't know, you can take like 37 selfies. You can choose the best one, you can put it on Facebook, and you can put a Botox filter on it. So all these guys, go away. People are putting their best foot forward. They're putting everything, the highlights of their life. But are they like that in real life? Probably not. Real people can smell that out. Superheroes all have backstories, and so do you. I was taught to own your own story. You see, because in your story, you make mistakes. I have made a lot of mistakes. But I learn from those mistakes. And the learning is what creates experience. And the experience is what gives you credibility so that you can speak about speaking on a topic and people want to listen. So that you can attract people that want to understand the information that you are providing. Somewhere in your story is your personal brand. Somewhere in your story is what you can use social media to communicate out there into the world. Now, what did this do for me? These three tools I used and I became a student again. I studied, I wrote, I spoke, I did everything I could with these three principles. Focus, 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 and focus. Using social media for a tool of attraction and just being real. What did that do for me? Publications started to pick up my articles. I started to have people reach out to me for my own expertise. I started to get my social media accounts verified. I have thousands of people that start to follow me. I get speaking engagements that are paid. I get paid to go to New York to speak. I get paid to go to Europe to speak. And I get asked to speak at the University of California, Irvine. Woo! Now, I thought I wanted to be a movie producer when I grew up, and I found out that I was passionate about communicating through storytelling. And that's what I do. I help people communicate through telling their stories. And I'll tell you what, I love my job. I love the people that I work with, and I love what I do. If I was here, and that's good, I'm up here. But you know the crazy thing is, when you're up here, and you're really good, things can go really bad, really fast. And on this given Monday, I was walking in feeling good. Monday, fun day. I'm like, look at this glorious cubicle. I'm so lucky to be here. It's such an amazing opportunity. And then the phone rings. And the caller ID says it's the big boss. Hello? Yeah. Right now? Sure. I'll see you in a second. Couldn't help but feel a little nervous as I walk to the doorway. And I do my typical, hey. No answer. He's on his computer. So I go and I sit down and I patiently wait for him. His eyes go from the computer and to me. And he says, Ryan, I've been watching you on social media. I said, I can totally explain. Look, I talked with my boss and it's all part of this thing I'm doing. He put his big boss hand out and I stopped. And he said, I've been watching you and I really, really like what you've been doing. You seem to be connecting with these millennials and we like it. In fact, UCI is creating a new position to run social media for 25 programs on campus to communicate with the undergrads. Are you interested? Yes. Yes, sir. And in that moment, the last 18 months of work on focusing on attracting the right things in my life through social media and on being real, I realized I don't have borderline millennial disorder anymore. I am a Gen X with millennial tendencies. You can be whatever you want to be when you grow up, even if you're grown up. And you can use social media as a tool to get there. And all it takes is three guiding principles. Number one, if you know it, say it with me. Focus. Number two, it's not a tool for distraction, but a tool of attraction. And number three, the most important, I want you to be really loud on this one. Don't be ideal, be
real.
Now, is that really as loud as you guys can get? One more time. Don't be ideal, be
real.
Thank you.